Good afternoon. The first item of business this afternoon is portfolio questions, and the first portfolio is Constitution, External Affairs and Culture. I would remind members that questions 4 and 8 are grouped together, and that therefore I will take any supplementaries on these questions after both have been answered. I call question number 1, Colette Stevenson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on what discussion it has had with stakeholders in Scotland affected by Brexit in preparation for any input that it will provide to the review of the UK-EU Trade and Cooperation Agreement.
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, may I begin by congratulating the Scottish Chamber Orchestra as they mark their 50th anniversary. Not only is the SCO a jewel in the Scottish cultural firmament, it's also outstanding in touring and performing throughout Scotland, supporting social inclusion and underlining the role that culture can bring to education, health and well-being. I'm sure colleagues across the Chamber will join me in congratulating Gavin Reid, SCO performers and conductors, past and present, all SCO staff, volunteers, directors, donors and supporters. In answer to Colette Stevenson's question, the TCA review is due in 2026, but we are not waiting until then to seek changes, not least because of recent research found that Brexit has cost the UK economy £69 billion last year. I hear from stakeholders regularly about Brexit, most recently at a meeting of the Scottish Advisory Forum on Europe in April, which I attended alongside the European Union's ambassador to the UK. The message from Scottish stakeholders was consistent. Brexit has increased costs and uncertainty for our businesses and diminished opportunities for our young people, and I have repeatedly pressed the UK government to address these self-inflicted harms.
Claire Stevenson.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that response. Has the Cabinet Secretary had any dialogue with the UK government regarding population policy following the enforcement of new post-Brexit immigration rule changes in light of the potential consequences on social care, universities and Scottish society?
Cabinet Secretary.
The simple answer is yes. Scottish ministers have written repeatedly to the UK government raising serious concerns on immigration changes. For example, we invited the Home Office to work with us to deliver our positively received rural visa pilot proposal, which would seek to address both labour market shortages and population challenges in rural and island communities. The United Kingdom government, however, rejected this proposal despite strong stakeholder support. Immigration is a cross-cutting policy with significant impact on areas of devolved responsibility, and Scotland should be able to attract talented and committed people from across the world to work and study here without excessive barriers.
Question number 2, Claire Hockey, who's joining us remotely. Ms Hockey.
To ask the Scottish Government how it is taking forward work to engage with the Scottish diaspora.
Cabinet Secretary.
Scotland embraces opportunities to strengthen its international relationships and better engaging with our diaspora. We believe it can benefit us both economically and culturally and improve Scotland's influence and reputation. In 2023, we published the Scottish Connections Framework, setting out our cross-cutting approach to strengthen relationships with Scotland's international groups and develop digital resources to help people join our Scottish Connections community. This year, we aim to establish an external advisory panel and launch the second round of the Scottish Connections Fund as we continue building relationships globally through our international offices, SDI, Global Scots, Trade and Investment Envoys and public bodies.
Claire Hockey.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. 2026 marks the 900th anniversary of the Charter of Rutherglen as a Royal Borough, and a growing programme of community-led events and celebrations is already being planned to celebrate the town's history and look towards the future. Rutherglen has a strong local identity of which its people are very proud, and many residents, past and present, have a keen interest in sharing their stories and memories. Can the Cabinet Secretary give further information about any support that is available to local groups and organisations to strengthen these connections and reach out to the wider Rutherglenian diaspora?
Cabinet Secretary.
So our digital tools for the diaspora are available on the www.scotland.org website to help people and organisations around the world, including Rutherglen, join our Scottish Connections community. And with our online registration service, anyone can register as a member of Scotland's international community to receive regular communications on news from Scotland or activity that's happening locally. Whether individuals are part of our heritage diaspora or or want to connect with Scottish business or education, or want to hear more about our arts and culture, our community directory brings together Scottish organisations and groups into one handy list.
Question number three, Michelle Thompson.
To ask the Scottish Government what assessment it has made of the impact of Brexit on young musicians.
Cabinet Secretary.
The Scottish Government recognises that the UK Government's decision to leave the European Union has had profoundly negative consequences for musicians in Scotland. It is particularly regrettable that younger, less well-established musicians are likely to have been more severely affected. Touring in Europe is now far more difficult, with the need for costly visas, work permits and customs restrictions. Stakeholders have indicated that younger musicians who may be at the start of their career may find these barriers harder to overcome due to being less well-established, experienced and with fewer resources. The loss of access to the Creative Europe programme has also had a major impact. This programme played a vital role in facilitating international cultural collaboration, helping young artists to develop cross-border networks, share knowledge and learn from their peers. The Scottish Government continues to call on the UK Government to rejoin Creative Europe.
Michelle Thompson.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for his response. At a recent round table I hosted with the European Movement, we heard compelling evidence on the impact of Brexit on young musicians. It was testimony from the singer Iona Fife that struck me the most. Still relatively early in her career, she anticipates the loss of free movement into Europe will have a significant impact. If we don't keep the young musicians in the profession who have the opportunities to grow and learn, make contacts, we therefore risk much of the social infrastructure and indeed the wider arts cluster. I'm aware of the very good work the Scottish Government has done to understand the immediate concerns of musicians generally, but I wonder whether the Scottish Government is collecting data from young musicians specifically over the longer term so that the wider impacts can be felt.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I think the point that Michelle Thompson makes is a very good one, and we work with and we support organisations that support young Scottish musicians. I was only recently at the Scottish Musical Showcase Wide Days, which does tremendous work in helping young musicians at the beginning of their career springboard into European markets for the first time. At the same time, I'd also like to put on the record our appreciation of the announcement by the European Commission that they would welcome a youth mobility arrangement with the United Kingdom, which would obviate a lot of the problems that we've been discussing this morning. It's extremely disappointing the UK government has already rejected it. It's even more disappointing in some respects that the Labour Party dismissed it even before the UK government did.
Supplementary, Beatrice Wishart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Shetland's Young Fiddler of the Year is an annual competition held in April, and it demonstrates the talent in the islands. But it's a great shame that our young musicians and touring artists are being stifled by Brexit red tape. So what constructive engagement has the Scottish Government had with UK counterparts to help resolve these constraints and any future changes after a UK general election?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I would very much hope, if there were to be a change of government in the next UK general election, that incoming government would look very quickly at U-turning on their rejection of the European Commission's proposal for a mobility scheme. I think that would be very welcome, and I think it would also be very welcome if the Liberal Democrats were to use their voice to speak in support of the European Commission's proposal. I think it was eminently sensible. I think, in addition, anything that we can do to change people's minds about schemes like Creative Europe, and for that matter, Erasmus Plus, are key. So where we can work together as parties across the chamber to support youth mobility and also to support the creative sector through the likes of Creative Europe, I think that's something that we should all embrace.
Question number four, Sarah Boyack.
Presiding Officer, to ask the Scottish Government what discussions the Culture Secretary has had with the Finance Secretary regarding future funding for culture in light of its commitment to invest an additional £100 million in the sector.
Cabinet Secretary.
We're increasing funding to the culture sector by £15.8 million this financial year to £196.6 million, and this is the first step on the route to investing at least £100 million more annually in culture and the arts by the financial year 28-29. In 25-26, we aim to provide an additional £25 million for the culture sector. I've highlighted to the Cabinet Secretary for Finance on a number of occasions, and recently also to the new First Minister and Deputy First Minister, the importance of this additional funding to the culture sector. As is normal procedure, the Scottish Budget for 25-26 will be published later in the year.
Sarah Boyack.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. 7 months ago, the pledge was made by the former First Minister, so we would have liked to have received more detail today on how organisations can access that critical finance. In Edinburgh, our world-class culture sector is hanging by a thread. The Filmhouse Open the Doors campaign has thankfully done very well, but the King's Theatre urgently needs major investment. And just this week, the Summerhall events venue is set to be put in the market. Our arts and culture sector is too important for government by press release. It needs urgent support and people need to know how to access funding. So will the Cabinet Secretary outline what that additional funding will be that is available, how people will be able to access it and how it will not only support but grow Edinburgh's world-class culture sector?
Cabinet Secretary.
So I think Sarah Boyack has identified both the challenge and the opportunity as we ramp up culture spending. Cultural organisations know how to get in touch with Creative Scotland. Cultural organisations know how to get in touch with the Scottish Government. They do regularly. That includes dealing with financial distress to venues that Sarah Boyack has mentioned, but others that are not in the public realm. And I can give her that assurance that the Scottish Government and arm's-length organisations like Creative Scotland take that distress extremely seriously, and we're trying to make sure that the financial means are there to deal with that. If Sarah Boyack wants to meet at any stage as somebody who I know is committed to the culture sector to discuss at greater length any priorities that she identifies or is aware of venues or organisations where early warning is required to make sure that they get through difficulty, I give her the assurance that we're absolutely seized of doing that, both in Edinburgh and throughout the rest of Scotland.
Question number 8, Liam Kerr.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government what discussions the Constitution Secretary has had with ministerial colleagues regarding the delivery of its commitment to invest at least £100 million more in culture and arts by the financial year 28-29.
Cabinet Secretary.
As I've already said just a moment ago in response to Ms Boyack's question, we are increasing funding to the culture sector by £15.8 million this financial year to £196.6 million, and it's the first step on the route to investing at least £100 million more annually in culture and the arts by the financial year 28-29, which I think is supported across the chamber. I will continue to hold discussions with ministerial colleagues about how best to support the culture sector going forward to deliver on our programme for government and culture strategy commitments on engaging across government to harness the transformational power of culture. As I've said repeatedly in this chamber, if there are members on all sides who have particular views on areas that they think need supported and they feel that this has not been this is well understood by government or indeed funding organisations, I make the offer that I've given to Sarah Boyack. I give that undertaking to Liam Kerr too. Perhaps he's got an example that he would wish to share now.
Liam Kerr.
Grateful to the Cabinet Secretary for that answer, and I'm going to press on it because I take the Cabinet Secretary in the spirit that he's offered his answer. The certainty is key for Scotland's brilliant culture sector to continue to invest, to innovate, to deliver on the world stage. So, Minister, referencing Sarah Boyack's point earlier, of the pledged £100 million, how much will be available to sustain the existing Scottish culture sector right now, and how much of the total allocation will it receive in each of the years up to 28-29?
So I think Liam Kerr understands enough about the budget process to know that £15.8 million has already been identified and has been committed in the current budget, that £25 million has been committed to in the next financial year. I see he's taking notes. He'll probably be able to work out that that leaves about another £60 million because this is an aggregate increase. So it's a rise to and then sustaining annual £100 million rise in culture. It's very considerable. I appreciate that he and other colleagues will wish that to ramp up as quickly as possible, and it's no secret that I do too. So anything that he and colleagues across the chamber can do to highlight where there are needs to provide funding to help the sector recover, especially from what has happened since COVID, is very much at the forefront of my mind. If he has particular venues or organisations or parts of the cultural arts sector he would wish to raise with me, my door is open to him and to all other colleagues.
I have received supplementary requests from four members. I would like to take all four of them, but I will need succinct questions and succinct answers. I call the supplementary, Megan Gallagher.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I am due to meet with the Cabinet Secretary shortly. However, I do want to bring his attention to the closure of Motherwell Concert Hall in my region, because it is a well-loved facility that has entertained many in Lanarkshire for decades, and I do want to emphasise the detrimental impact on local economies and the restriction of the growth of talent who rely on smaller venues to get their big break. So can I ask the Cabinet Secretary how he will work with local councils in particular to save these much-loved music venues that are of substantial cultural heritage and importance, given the announcement of investment in this sector?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I thank Megan Gallagher for raising this question. Perhaps it's a preview of the conversation that we're going to have, which I very much look forward to. These challenges are issues which I discussed with the Music Venue Trust only a few weeks ago, and we're very well aware of the fact that there are a significant number of venues that have been suffering from distress, and it's also the case that in some parts of the country that local authorities are no longer supporting local venues. So I think we all need to work together as parliamentarians, colleagues in local government, the Scottish Government and our arm's length funding organisations to make sure that we maintain the infrastructure of venues right across the country. I'll undertake to have a look at the example that she's raised today so that I have more information at my fingertips to discuss when we meet shortly. And it's a very good example of areas where I think that we can be working constructively together.
Supplementary, Faisal Chowdhury.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Cabinet Secretary may claim today that the Scottish Government is acting to protect the arts and culture sector, but the situation on the ground is a different story. Cancelled festivals, cultural organisations calling out for greater support from the Scottish Government. It is clear our cultural sector is under enormous pressure. So will the Cabinet Secretary heed Labour's call for a crisis summit on festival funding?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, as I've said already to both Faisal Chowdhury and other colleagues on the Labour benches, we are engaged in an ongoing dialogue with festivals. And we are discussing their funding, and we are discussing how they can emerge from the current financial distress to the sector. I regularly, on a weekly basis, I'm talking with colleagues in the festival sector. I think we're all committed, I think, across this chamber to make sure that our major cultural events are sustainable. I'm sure he will join with me in welcoming the record numbers, I think they were, of participants in the Edinburgh Festival Fringe for this year. So there's a lot of good news that we should be highlighting, and at the same time recognising that where there is financial distress, we need to do everything that we can to make sure that our festivals, our venues and our cultural organisations are not only able to survive, but to thrive in the years to come.
Supplementary, Claire Hawkey.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The culture sector has had to endure the shock of Brexit fallout, the pandemic, the energy crisis and the mismanagement of the economy by the UK government. How will this fund ensure vital support for the sector at this critical juncture and ensure it can fully respond to those pressures?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, this is exactly what the Scottish Government and Creative Scotland are trying to do. We're trying to make sure that where there is financial distress, that there are interventions in place to make sure that venues, organisations are able to continue trading and are able to turn around their circumstances. And there have been a significant number of interventions which have done just that, and I would like to put on record my appreciation to colleagues in the Culture Directorate of the Scottish Government and colleagues in Creative Scotland and indeed Screen Scotland, who have made sure that well-known and loved events will continue into the future. But we need to think more medium and long-term than just dealing with the immediate crisis. We need to make sure that multi-annual year funding, which I think everybody is supportive of, is rolled out successfully, and that with the increase of funding which this government is committed to and this government is committed to is delivering, I have to say, in contrast to both the UK government and
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Thank you. I'm keen to call Mark Ruscoe, supplementary. Mark Ruscoe.
Thank you. Last week, the Culture, Media and Sports Select Committee in Westminster urged the UK government to press ahead with a UK-wide arena ticket levy preceded by an interim voluntary scheme led by industry. Absolutely essential, Cabinet Secretary, to prevent these grassroots music venues from closing. They absolutely need that investment. I know that he's been very supportive of ticket levy in the past, so can I ask him today when we might see a stadium tax introduced in Scotland?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, the issue that he raises is one that I discussed in detail with the Music Venue Trust. I think he probably met them when their delegation was here last week, when they were also attending the Wide Days musical showcase in Edinburgh. There are a number of models, as he knows, which are being proposed. I raised this directly with the UK Culture Secretary because, as I think Mark Ruskell understands, not all of this is within the powers of devolution. So, as I have said to him, I am very interested in learning about deliverable and workable ways in which extra funding can be leveraged into the culture and arts sector. And so I suppose, in summary, this is a work in progress, and I very much hope that the UK Government is listening both to ourselves and the Music Venues Trust.
Question number five, Alexander Stewart.
Ask the Scottish Government how it can ensure that the public have confidence in the arts and culture sector.
Cabinet Secretary.
The commitment to investing at least £100 million more annually in culture and the arts by the financial year 28-29, despite the challenging budget situation, signals our confidence in the Scottish culture sector and is the starting point of a journey of three phases. Firstly, to sustain, then to develop and to innovate. And through this increased investment, we want to drive up opportunities for participation in creative pursuits, support the production of new works and ensure that Scotland's cultural output has platforms both at home and internationally.
Alexander Stewart.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that response. The new Deputy First Minister recently said that the economic choices we make now, this year, will determine whether Scotland reaps the benefits for decades to come or forever laments on missed opportunities. However, we are still hearing no mention of arts and culture. Therefore, Cabinet Secretary, is the new Cabinet going to be one of continuity, or are we finally going to see tangible support for an industry worth billions and supporting tens of thousands of jobs?
Cabinet Secretary.
So Alistair Stewart has been here for the entirety of this portfolio questions, and he will have heard me repeatedly underlining the Scottish Government's commitment, one held right across government, including the First Minister and the Deputy First Minister, to increase culture funding whilst it has been cut by the UK Government in England and the Labour Government in Wales. We're absolutely committed to be supporting our culture and arts sector. And at the same time, because he's highlighting economic success, we shouldn't omit an awareness of some fantastic stories. For example, the screen sector, which has already reached a stage of an annual gross value added to the Scottish economy of over £600 million, and by the year 2030 of £1 billion. So there's some really good news stories that are having a major economic impact. We want to support the screen sector, the rest of the culture and arts sector to succeed, and I hope that he will support us in those endeavours.
And supplementary, Neil Bibby.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It is vital that the public has confidence in relation to decisions affecting the arts and culture sector. According to the Ministerial Code, as a representative of the Edinburgh Central constituency, the Cabinet Secretary must recuse himself from decisions which affect the area to avoid any conflicts of interest, and there have been concerns raised about this in recent days. Given Edinburgh Central is a hub of cultural activity, the home of the Edinburgh Festivals, and the Cabinet Secretary no longer has a Deputy Culture Minister, can I ask him to clarify today which Minister, in the interest of public confidence, will take on responsibility for these decisions, on what grounds and what opportunity will there be for members to hold that minister to account?
Cabinet Secretary.
So Neil Bibby is absolutely right to ask about changes in government and what that then means in the decision-making process. The good news is that when it comes to major culture decisions, and that includes our festivals, which are national events, that's still the responsibility of the Cabinet Secretary for Culture, namely me. If there are any day-to-day issues or areas where there might be grounds for recusal, the minister that will have responsibility in those cases is the Deputy First Minister, Kate Forbes.
Question number six, Jimmy Green.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to reports that over half of applications to Creative Scotland could be turned down as a result of, quote, standstill funding from the Scottish Government.
Cabinet Secretary.
So the Scottish Government provides significant funding to Creative Scotland each year. Creative Scotland received applications from 281 cultural organisations at stage two of their multi-year funding, with a total ask of £87.5 million per year. I expect that this ask will reduce as Creative Scotland undertake their due diligence and assessment of applications.
Jamie Green.
Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that response? And I hope you will also join me in congratulating the new Wylam Gallery in Greenock, which has recently opened. I do invite him, if he hasn't been down already, to come and visit, and I'll happily treat him to a spot of lunch if he does. But there are wider concerns around some of the funding mechanisms that Creative Scotland are in charge of. One industry collective called Culture Counts estimated that over half of the applications may be turned down. The phrase standstill funding is a quotation directly from Creative Scotland. It's their belief that funding is not increasing at the rate that they would expect or hope it to. I wonder if the Cabinet Secretary shares my concern. It's not just the size of the pie, which is too worryingly small, but it's actually the method in which it's been carved up, which may leave many in our culture sector disappointed.
Cabinet Secretary.
So the first thing I would say is, Jamie Green knows this, Creative Scotland operates as an arm's length organisation. It's not for culture secretaries to instruct which bits of culture funding that is dispersed through Creative Scotland should be dispersed. And Creative Scotland regularly gives evidence to the Scottish Parliament, so members of the relevant committees can ask questions about that. Culture Counts isn't just any cultural organisation, it is an umbrella organisation, and I look very closely at what they have to say about all of these things. And they also regularly give evidence to Scottish Parliament committees and publish excellent reports that I read very closely. So I agree with Jamie Green that we have to make sure that the maximum amount of money that we are able to give to the disposal of Creative Scotland, but also to our national performing companies. Earlier we were talking about the Scottish Chamber Orchestra, where there has been an increase in government funding to our national performing companies. We need to make sure that right across the sector that funding is apportioned
Thank
fairly,
you, Cabinet Secretary.
And that's
Thank
exactly
you. I will take a supplementary, Roger Grant. Briefly, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Creative Scotland's current funding model, providing three-year funding, has resulted in the Hebridean Celtic Festival, one of the most important events in my region, to face a catastrophic funding gap post-2024. Combined with the removal of local authority funding, this means that there is no prospect of any public funding till 2028 at the earliest. The Cabinet Secretary is aware that the festival would remove millions of pounds from the local economy that desperately needs it. So will he look at the funding model and review how Creative Scotland provides funding and its processes and policies to make sure that we don't lose jewels such as the Hebkelt Festival?
So I think it's only fair to acknowledge that when there's a new system of funding that is introduced, obviously those organisations, those venues that receive funding are often delighted, but one hears a lot less about that than you hear about different venues or organisations that have not been successful in the bidding process. And I agree absolutely with Rhoda Grant that we need to best understand the ways in which transitional arrangements can be made to make sure that organisations do not face a cliff edge, as she has identified. That's very much part of my thinking. And if she and her colleagues on the front bench have ideas about the optimal mechanism for making sure that that happens, obviously we're going to learn about multi-annual year funding, the second phase, later this year. If there are any specific suggestions, I'd be really interested in hearing them.
And question number seven, Liz Smith.
To ask the Scottish Government what events it has planned to commemorate the 80th anniversary of the Normandy landings on June the 6th.
Cabinet Secretary.
The Scottish Government remembers and respects the service and sacrifice of the brave veterans who fought on D-Day and in Normandy 80 years ago. As such, we are funding a Scottish national commemorative event in partnership with Legion Scotland. This will consist of a concert at the Usher Hall on the 6th of June, which will pay tribute to the heroism of our D-Day veterans. In addition, Legion Scotland and Pobby Scotland are working to develop educational materials which aim to raise awareness of D-Day across the generations and communities in Scotland.
Could I thank the Cabinet Secretary, and I'm sure we wish all those participating in these events every success. The Cabinet Secretary will know that MSPs recently received information from the historic Royal Palaces Access Fund about how schools can apply for financial assistance for visits, a charitable organisation that's working with government. And I wonder if the Cabinet Secretary can tell us what work is ongoing between the Scottish Government and charitable organisations to facilitate a greater number of school visits to our historical sites, such as the D-Day Atlantic Wall in Sheriffmuir in my constituency area.
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I say on the generality of the point that Liz Smith has raised, I think it's excellent to highlight that there are ways in which school groups can take part in particular events. Without advance notice of the question, she'll forgive me for not having the detailed answer to the question that she asked. I agree with her in general terms. I undertake to look specifically at the point that she raises and get back to her, because I think if there's any way in which we can amplify the awareness that there are funds, there are ways to support schools and pupils being able to attend these important events, I would wish the Scottish Government to be supportive of that.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. That concludes the portfolio questions on Constitution, External Affairs and Culture. There will be a very short pause before we move on to the next portfolio in order to allow frontbench teams to change position should they so wish. Thank you. Thank you. The next portfolio this afternoon is Justice and Home Affairs. And at question number one, I call Keith Brown.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide a further update on the Scottish Prison Service's work to address reported noise disturbance at HMP Stirling.
Cabinet Secretary Angela Constance.
Presiding Officer, as the member will appreciate, this is largely an operational issue for the Scottish Prison Service. The noise complaints do, however, continue to be taken very seriously by both myself and the SPS. SPS continue to engage with residents and their elected officials regarding operational and infrastructural actions they are taking to help reduce noise coming from parts of the prison. Further substantial measures will require additional investment and time to ensure they are effective, value for money, and meet the needs of those women living at HMP and YOI Stirling, many of whom are vulnerable. I know that the member will shortly be meeting with SPS at HMP and YOI Stirling to discuss his concerns directly.
Keith Brown.
Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for her answer, and I do appreciate this is a matter primarily for SPS, but we met in a public meeting over 6 months ago and were given assurances by SPS of action to be taken, and very little has happened. My constituents continually report there has been little improvement to the disruption they've suffered for nearly a year now. Indeed, they've been asked to be patient and consider, as the Cabinet Secretary says, the well-being of the inmates. But there appears to be no real appreciation of the impact of the situation on my constituents' mental health and well-being. Recently, the police have been called. Two-year-old children are repeating the profanities that they hear over the fence. Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary, therefore, what advice or what further action can be taken by SPS to immediately address the issues raised by my constituents that will deliver a fast and effective solution to a deeply distressing situation which is impacting so negatively on the local community?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I take very, very seriously the issues that Mr Brown raises on behalf of his constituents, and indeed I have seen some of the correspondence from his constituents and their personal testimony about the distress and disruption that they are experiencing. Let me reassure him that Scottish Prison Service do continue to work through what is a somewhat complex matter. Many of the women in the care of the Prison Service have significant needs and require intensive engagement to support them through periods of heightened state and crisis. I am informed of the enhanced engagement by prison officers that has resulted in a drop in the instances of excessive noise emitting from the prison, showing that this approach is working, at least to some extent. So SPS are also working to identify additional options that further mitigate the noise, and I can assure the member I will discuss this again with the Chief Executive when I next meet her.
Supplementary, Alexander Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Cabinet Secretary, the present situation needs to be urgently resolved for residents, staff and prisoners as we enter now the 11th month of these disturbances. Residents' children are unable to play in their garden. They are subjected to swearing and abusive behaviour and language. They are suffering from sleep deprivation and stress, resulting in residents having no option but to move at a financial loss. So, Cabinet Secretary, once again, what further pressure can be put on the Scottish Prison Service to end this misery and suffering and resolve the situation by relocating these prisoners to other parts within the prison estate?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, let me once again assure Mr Stewart, as I have with Mr Brown, that I take his concerns extremely seriously. I hear the representation that Mr Stewart has made in a very considered manner over many months. We know that the noise primarily comes from the Enhanced Needs Unit and the Segregation and Reintegration Unit. There are three key areas of action for the Scottish Prison Service around the operational interventions, and I've spoke to that earlier, but also to improve the physical estate, and of course monitoring and communication with those affected is vital. But I will raise this once again with the Scottish Prison Service and get back to both Mr Stewart and Mr Brown.
And supplementary, Mark Ruskell.
I think the Cabinet Secretary knows that this situation is utterly, utterly intolerable for those living near the prison. The SPS has offered mitigations. They're not working. The whole community, both inside and outside of the prison, deserve a lot better. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree that, as Mr Stewart has already said, that the only real option left on the table is to move the living quarters within HMP Stirling to a different part of the site? I simply cannot see another way to solve this problem. If there is another way, we need to hear it fast from SPS and we need to see action.
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I won't repeat what I've said to members previously in this exchange, but to say to Mr Ruskell that I will discuss this with SPS about what further actions can be timiously implemented to give respite to residents. And I take on board, again, his considered remarks that the situation needs to be improved, both for those living within the care of the prison service, but also the residents.
Question number two, Willie Coffey, who's joining us remotely. Mr Coffey.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government how it is tackling antisocial behaviour.
Minister Siobhan Brown.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Police Scotland and local authorities have a wide range of powers to tackle antisocial behaviour. We support them in using these appropriately and are investing in prevention and early intervention. Our Cashback for Communities programme and Violence Prevention Framework takes preventative approaches to antisocial behaviour and violence. The current three-year phase of Cashback commits £20 million to early intervention work and positive opportunities for young people in communities across Scotland. Our independent expert working group on antisocial behaviour is examining our strategic approach to antisocial behaviour and considering how we can improve, and the group will report in late 2024.
Willie Coffey.
I thank the Minister for that answer. As she knows herself, antisocial behaviour is a cause for concern in many constituencies, and particularly around our bus stations, where the travelling public and transport staff are often affected by this. Is there any further progress possible to address this, for example, by removing the bus passes from persistent offenders, if this is shown to be a cause, or indeed to deploy dispersal orders that I understand are being used elsewhere in Scotland to ensure that our bus stations are safe and welcoming for everyone?
Minister.
Thank you, and I thank the member for raising this issue. And he will be aware that the vast majority of young people travelling by bus do behave appropriately. The legislation underpinning the current schemes does not provide a clear mechanism for cards just to be removed in cases of antisocial behaviour, and free bus travel is just one of the several services provided through the card.
Transport Scotland are continuing to explore what deterrents and sanctions may be possible and appropriate in these cases, and the member should note that the Antisocial Behaviour Scotland Act 2004 already provides a wide range of measures for dealing with all antisocial behaviour, including dispersal orders, which can be considered by the police in consultation with the local authority on an individual or temporary basis.
A supplementary, Craig Coy.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. One of the unintended consequences of free bus travel for under-22s is the rise in antisocial behaviour identified by Mr Coffey. Communities from Dumfries to Dunbar have reported groups of youths who abuse the scheme to travel to towns away from their own to engage in vandalism and other ASB activities, often causing extreme distress to drivers and passengers along the route. This has recently been raised with me by a resident in Pencaitland who reported, and I quote, not just rowdy but dangerous and threatening behaviour that ranges from arson to vandalism to verbal and physical assaults. Given that the next review of free bus travel is not until 2025, will the Minister now agree to meet with fellow ministers, particularly transport ministers, police, bus companies, trade unions and those communities affected to pragmatically but urgently address this unacceptable abuse of the scheme?
Minister.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Just so Mr Hoy is aware, there has been ongoing engagement with Police Scotland and bus companies as well, with the Cabinet Secretary for Transport and myself in recent months, and this is ongoing. As I said, Transport Scotland are looking at ways at the moment with the card, but it is not a clear mechanism just to take the card away at the moment, but we will continue to engage.
Question number three, James Dornan, who is joining us remotely. Mr Dornan.
To ask the Scottish Government what progress is being made towards implementing its Vision for Justice in Scotland delivery plan.
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, good progress has been made across the justice sector to meet our vision of a just, safe and resilient Scotland. Our delivery plan provides an overview of work being done across the sector to the end of this parliamentary term. We have launched the Violence Prevention Framework for Scotland, are rolling out digital evidence sharing capability following its successful pilot, and have expanded summary case management for domestic abuse cases into Glasgow. Progress continues to have tangible effects on the people of Scotland, with statistics showing recorded crime remaining at one of the lowest levels since 1974.
James Dornan.
Thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer and welcome the substantial improvement in many areas across the justice system. But what further action could the Scottish Government take if they had the full range of policy and operational tools needed to keep the people of Scotland safe, to build on its strong record of reducing crime and keeping people safe from harm?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, while justice in Scotland is predominantly devolved, the recent Justice in an Independent Scotland paper sets out opportunities that could be taken with independence. Having the full range of policy and operational tools, it would provide new choices, new chances for Scotland to take a different approach in areas such as serious organised crime, firearms and human trafficking. Independence would allow us, for example, to extend our public health approach to violence reduction, where we focus on prevention into currently reserved areas like drug policy reform and gambling. And of course, rejoining the EU would ensure that Scotland could enjoy the benefits of access to the systems and networks that were lost following Brexit, including access to the European Arrest Warrant and the Schengen Information System.
Russell Finlay, supplementary.
Thank you. Every single police officer across the UK has the protection of body-worn cameras as standard, except for here in Scotland, which remains a shameful failing of the SNP government. Now, the Vision for Justice delivery plan sets out a timeline for cameras. So can the Cabinet Secretary explain if this is on track and tell us when Scottish officers will get the protection that they deserve?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I'm very pleased to say to Mr Finlay that there will be some good news on this front imminent and within the next week, and I wouldn't like to spoil that experience for him at the start of next week.
And supplementary, Katie Clark.
The delivery plan refers to the modernisation of the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service, but not the state of the fire estate, although a national review of the service has been published. Nearly half of the fire estate has been assessed as being in either bad or poor condition. What priority is the Scottish Government giving to the lack of adequate decontamination facilities available to many firefighters, given the serious medical consequences of contact with toxins?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, Ms Clark raises a crucially important point with respect to the fire estate, some of which is somewhat aged and indeed affected by RAAC. That was one of the reasons why this government, despite the new age of austerity that we're operating in, have increased both the resource and the capital budget available to the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service. And I know that the Minister, along with other partners, and in particular the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service, is looking to progress the work in and around contamination, because the health of our firefighters has to be of the utmost importance.
Question number four, not large. Question number five, Colin Smith.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to reports that police officer numbers have fallen to their lowest level since the establishment of Police Scotland.
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, despite the deeply challenging financial circumstances, our budget settlement for 2024-25 for Police Scotland includes an additional £75.7 million to protect frontline policing. As the Chief Constable confirmed to the Criminal Justice Committee, this investment will enable Police Scotland to bring officer numbers up to around 16,500 to 16,600. This week, we are expecting another 120 officers to commence training, in addition to the almost 200 new officers joining in March, with further recruitment intakes planned across the year. Scotland continues to have more police officers per capita than England and Wales, with 30 officers per 10,000 of the population, compared to 24 in England and Wales.
Colin Smith.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The cuts in police numbers are leaving our officers overwhelmed and overstretched. Many are leaving the service and mental health absences are soaring. The Scottish Police Federation say the service is becoming a reactive service, and they warn that the lack of community police gathering intelligence will lead to higher organised crime. Cabinet Secretary, hasn't that cut in police numbers on your watch left Police Scotland in crisis, and what action will she take to restore that confidence with the Police Federation and officers, which has been broken as a result of those cuts in police numbers?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I've already outlined to the member that with the start of this financial year, we have reported additional recruitment. As this year progresses, we will see further recruitment, which will boost frontline police officer numbers. I want to assure Mr Smith that there is a central priority around local policing. The Chief Constable has been absolutely crystal clear about that, and also about ensuring that the service doesn't become a purely reactive service. And that's why she very much welcomed the significant additional investment that this government is making here and now. And in terms of his remarks around the importance of mental health, both of serving police officers, but also in terms of how they are at present expected to respond to the mental health needs of the community. I'm happy to write to him further about the breadth and depth of work that's going on to ensure that police officers can be more focused on policing, and that other partners also play their part.
A brief supplementary, please, Sharon Dowie.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Our police force is underfunded and overstretched. They've been forced to no longer investigate thousands of crimes. There are not enough officers, and the force doesn't have enough resources to perform its duties. As a result, the public will be put at greater risk. Does the Cabinet Secretary accept that fewer officers could mean more victims of crime?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I dispute the fact that our police service is underfunded, as year on year we have continued to increase investment in Police Scotland since 2016. I've already outlined the significant work in and around recruitment that will progress this year. And I also think it is a sorry state of affairs when people continue to misrepresent the current practice of Police Scotland and servant police officers when the information is available and that Police Scotland have rightly said that in the interest of transparency, that they will continue to investigate all crimes. It is only where there are no reasonable lines of inquiry that they will quickly provide information to members of the public. And this new way of working is actually assisting to free up police officer hours. And if you look at the North East pilot, for example, that has freed up over 2,600 police officer hours.
And brief supplementary, please, Beatrice Wishart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. We know that there are impacts on mental health, mental well-being, given the difficult role police officers have, and the impact of attending incidents involving mental health cases is one factor. What additional support services can be put in place to support officers in order to help retain and increase numbers in Police Scotland?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, there is particular support available for police officers who very often in their day-to-day work have to run towards danger as opposed to run away from danger, and therefore it is imperative that we support their well-being if they have been exposed to traumatic instances. But it is also crucial that we support their well-being due to the day-to-day stresses of their job, because I think we would all acknowledge that policing is a demanding role that they do on behalf of us all.
Question number six, Gillian Mackay.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update ahead of the introduction of the proposed Post Office Horizon System Offences Scotland Bill, including in relation to the potential overturning of any wrongful convictions of postmasters in Scotland that were based on evidence from the Post Office's Horizon computer system.
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, as the member will be aware, the Scottish Government has introduced the Post Office Horizon System Offences Scotland Bill. While we have always maintained that a UK-wide approach would be the best way to achieve parity for the sub-postmasters and sub-postmistresses across the UK who were convicted on the basis of tainted evidence from the Post Office Horizon system, the UK Government have chosen to exclude Scotland from the scope of the bill. Nonetheless, the Scottish Bill will therefore seek to ensure that those affected by the Horizon scandal can receive justice by having their convictions quashed, and postmasters will also have access to compensation via the UK scheme in the same way as their English and Welsh counterparts.
Gillian Mackay.
Many of those prosecuted using Horizon evidence have already been seeking justice for wrongful prosecution, and all of their lives have been monumentally affected by these failures. Given that the UK Government has so far declined to pursue the Post Office or partner Fujitsu in respect of bonuses granted in relation to Horizon, has the Scottish Government considered addressing this corporate wrongdoing through the forthcoming bill or by other means?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, due to the nature of devolved and reserved matters, it would be somewhat difficult for the Scottish Government to address issues of corporate culpability. The ongoing public inquiry by Wynne Williams is of critical importance, and obviously we stand by to play our part as necessary in any of those recommendations when they come. And I know that my colleague Neil Gray in his previous post made strenuous representations and expressed the view of this government to Fujitsu around their involvement with respect to the Post Office.
Brief supplementary, Rona Mackay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The UK-wide use of the tainted Horizon computer system evidence was a decision of the Post Office. As such, does the Cabinet Secretary share my concern that the recent coverage makes it clear that over the last number of years, those at the top of the Post Office have repeatedly obscured and provided misleading information?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, following on from my reply to Gillian Mackay, I can say to Ms Mackay, I have been following with interest the progress of the UK inquiry, and I am of course concerned about the information emerging about the Post Office investigations and the prosecution of innocent postmasters. We must allow the inquiry to take its course. However, while the inquiry progresses, our focus firmly remains addressing the grave miscarriages of justice through the Post Office Horizon System Offences Scotland Bill, which will bring parity of justice for postmasters in Scotland.
And brief supplementary, Pauline McNeill.
Thank you. Scottish Labour welcomes the Post Office Horizon System Offences Scotland Bill. Will the Cabinet Secretary consider that there might be related offences? There is evidence of a case that I'm aware of where a sub-postmaster was accused of defrauding £35,000, but to save his mother from jail, the son pled guilty to what we now know is cash that didn't go missing at all, and he was subsequently convicted. I wonder if the Cabinet Secretary would just be open-minded that he's as much a victim of the Horizon scandal as his mother was, and if there's a way to fix it in this bill, would the Cabinet Secretary give that some consideration?
Presiding Officer, of course we will be open-minded as we progress. We do need to take considerable care, though, and I just say that in terms of being upfront and in the interests of parity, because we want to ensure as much as possible that the Scottish Bill mirrors the English and Welsh and Northern Irish Bill as far as possible in Scots law, so that we have that parity of access to justice and, crucially, to compensation.
Question number 7, Alexander Burnett.
To ask the Scottish Government when the Justice Secretary last met with the Lord Advocate.
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I meet with law officers both formally and informally on a regular basis to discuss a range of issues, and I last met formally with the Lord Advocate and Solicitor General on the 18th of April.
Alexander Burnett.
For over 5 years, a constituent of mine who is a victim of domestic abuse has been failed by the SNP justice system. Across two criminal cases, there have been a total of 24 deferrals because the defendant has failed to turn up, refused to employ legal representation, refused court-appointed solicitors, and failed to engage with court-appointed social workers. I've written numerous times to the Procurator Fiscal, the Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service, the Lord Advocate, and 8 times to the Cabinet Secretary. None have achieved anything, and all referring me to each other, and all this time my constituent's suffering is prolonged. Defendants should be taken into custody if they repeatedly fail to turn up, and courts should have more powers to appoint solicitors. So can I ask the Cabinet Secretary what action will she take to prevent this stalling tactic?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I am indeed aware, more than aware, of Mr Burnett's correspondence on behalf of his constituent. I have, of course, referred in previous correspondence to the work we are doing to ensure that additional investment in the court system can assist in ensuring that our systems are more efficient and effective, both at holding people to account but actually getting quicker resolutions. I would be happy to meet with Mr Burnett if that was at all helpful. As I've also said to Mr Burnett previously, I do of course have to be respectful of those independent players, both in terms of the judiciary, the Lord Advocate and other actors in the system. But I do recognise the considerable trauma that his constituent has experienced.
And question number 8, Liam MacArthur.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on its engagement with stakeholders in the legal sector regarding the provision of legal aid.
Minister Siobhan Brown.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Vision for Justice in Scotland 3-year delivery plan contains an action to reform the legal aid system and engage with key stakeholders to inform and shape future legislative proposals. Any future proposals will build upon the Martin Evans review recommendations and subsequent public consultation. Officials will engage in a series of stakeholder engagement sessions. I jointly chair a working group with the Law Society of Scotland and the Faculty of Advocates convened to consider the future of the legal profession in Scotland, and I regularly meet with the Law Society and Faculty of Advocates, and recently met with the Scottish Solicitors Bar Association, and provision of legal aid was discussed.
Lee MacArthur.
I thank the Minister for her response. Over recent years, there's been a marked drop in the availability of criminal legal aid. Figures published from the Scottish Legal Aid Board now show there are no private solicitors taking part in either court or the police station duty schemes in my Orkney constituency. This is obviously deeply concerning, yet the Law Society recently confirmed that it's withdrawn from talks with the government, citing, quote, no tangible progress in reforming legal aid. So what steps will the Minister now take to prevent rural and island areas from becoming effectively legal aid deserts?
Minister.
Thank you. The legal aid system is a national one, and it is flexible enough to allow services to be delivered by solicitors around the country to people all around the country. There are numerous ways in which access to solicitors can be facilitated remotely, and funding is available to allow solicitors to travel to rural and remote parts of the country to carry out work, meaning individuals do not have to rely on local provision alone when seeking publicly funded legal assistance. We will continue to hold discussions with with the legal profession on the main areas of concern for legal aid. Both the Law Society and the SSBA are aware that the offer to re-tender for the research remains. Through successful engagement with the legal profession, the Scottish Government has delivered significant investment into the legal aid system over recent years. The most recent package of fee reforms and increases was delivered on the 29th of April last year and took the total additional funding to legal aid to £31 million since April 2021.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes portfolio questions on Justice and Home Affairs. There will be a short pause before we move on to the next item of business to allow frontbench teams to change positions should they so wish. Thank you.